Hacienda Heights, California, 20 miles to the southeast of Hollywood. Nothing much ever came out of Hacienda Heights except talented high school athletes and traffic jams on the 60 freeway. In fact, in the summer of 1993, there was little to suggest that this small community would become the birthplace of a successful community access show that would captivate and change local television as we know it. Marty's Corner. Marty's Corner, a one-of-a-kind show. Like all unlikely successes, it was both inventive and creative. It reflected and expressed the spirit of its time. It seems as though it came from nowhere, so sudden was its success. But behind it lay 10 years of hard work and frequent disappointments. Yet the cast and crew were determined, adapting to changes in management and show locales. But most of all, the show was good, crafting a distinct style out of the talents of both cast and crew. The show would change over the years, and when times became tough, the show would reach back to the enthusiasm and dreams it had at the beginning. Marty Shields. In July of 1993, Marty was out of work at 33 and going back to college. A married father of three, he had been playing drums in garage bands for more than 10 years. 3 years prior, his band shot a music video at United Artists Television Studio in Hacienda Heights. Although he knew nothing about TV, he was fascinated and jumped at the opportunity. The video did little to help his band, but the experience intrigued him. For the next 2 years, he continued to book and play shows with the band, but his interest in creating a TV show was piqued. In an attempt to both help his band and scratch his TV itch, he began to volunteer down at the studio. He learned basic TV production. A vision began to form in his head. He wanted to produce a program that would showcase both local and professional bands and musicians.
I wanted to combine the comedy that I had grown up with and use as part of my performing, and also do the rock and roll thing too.
Robert Hansen was the engineer in charge of production at United Artists Cable Channel 32. He felt it was a good idea, but a lot of good ideas never were produced by residents who had the opportunity. Marty needed help. He couldn't do it alone. Frank Atencio was a talented computer whiz with an offbeat sense of humor. A friend and bandmate of Marty's, he was an unlikely person to get involved in a television show, and was always interested in projects that would allow him to express himself. In late 1991, he was in between jobs and looking forward to working with Marty on this new project.
Front Row at the Hop was going to be a show that Marty was going to basically MC. So it was going to be like the entertainers, and I guess that when they got done entertaining, they'd come sit down with Marty.
Front Row at the Hop was the working title for the show. It was to be videotaped at the Hop nightclub in the City of Industry. The club's booking agent liked the concept, and Marty was given the go to find sponsors to pay for the rental of the television production van. The production van at the station was going to cost $1,000 a show. When the station management saw that this show had a possibility of picking up sponsors, the rate for the van went up to $2,500. Without a single frame of videotape to show, the endeavor lost speed and failed. Undeterred, Marty found another way to get his show produced. The studios at Channel 32 also had a community access side. After finding out he didn't need sponsors at Channel 33 and feeling that the station could use a late-night variety show, he signed up for the station's production classes. In a short 6 weeks, he was certified to produce programs at Channel 33. This time, he pitched the show to the channel station manager, Candy Larson. She liked the idea and gave him the go. The concept had changed in 2 years. Marty was now going to school for television production and wanted to do a late-night variety show. It was to be broadcast live and feature a live in-house band, dancers, and a live studio audience. The staff at Channel 33 thought he was nuts. Now he had a mere 6 weeks to write a script, find guests, cast, and crew. but where to find a house band. He went to his current bandmates for help. Frank was in to play guitar on the show. He ran the idea by bass player Albert Alcarez. Albert Alcarez had been a saxophone player in his college band when he and Marty first met at work. Switching to bass guitar, he joined Marty in Frank's band in 1991. When he was approached by Marty to play on the show, he was interested. Conveniently, he rented a room from Marty.
He wanted to have kind of like a 60s show with a band in the corner, and I guess that's where the corner band came from. And since Frank and I were already available, so he just enlisted us, basically.
The clock was ticking, and Marty hastily shot a promotional spot for the show.
If you show it, they will watch.
If you show it, they will watch. I'll get my own community access show. Yeah!
Dad, are you okay?
Oh. If I show it, they will watch. If I show it, they will watch.
He had a guitarist and bass player. A drummer would have to wait. Now he had to put together a crew. Jack Rodriguez was a maintenance part manager for Zaki Farms and a veteran producer and cameraman for community television in Hacienda Heights. His leanings were toward Little League and sports productions. When asked to work on the crew in early August of 1993, he said yes. He had no idea that some 10 years later, he would still be on the crew.
Well, I've been with Community Access for a couple of years doing sports, Little League baseball and football and stuff like that. And I wanted to do something different. And Marty's show sounded like it would be a lot of fun.
Marty's wife was part of the crew as floor manager. When they needed help in watching their children because of the long hours at the studio and live broadcasts, they got help from his wife's brother, Tony, who offered to babysit his nieces and nephew. Everyone's help was needed to get this show off the ground. Now Marty wanted to find dancers and an announcer. He was introduced to model and actress Lori Sobrito Jimenez. Lori was a part-time fragrance model who had done print work and acted in local theater. She was added to the cast as a dancer and show's announcer.
Well, how we met was at my day job. I met Marty's wife, and I overheard her talking one day, and she was saying, "My husband's going to do a community access show, and he needs help and volunteers." And I said, "Excuse me? I'm an actress. I used to dance. I'll do something."
Marty wasn't quite ready to go. The crew was incomplete, and the band didn't have a drummer. But on August 20th, 1993, viewers in Hacienda Heights and La Puente got their first glimpse of Marty's Corner.
It's Friday night. It's time to party with our host, Marty Shields.
The first show was just a debacle.
The first show.
We didn't know what we were doing. And I had one of these hook-on microphones, and I'd never put one on before. And I was trying to find the darn thing and looking for it. And we were on live.
It was live.
It was live. It was dead air, the worst thing you could possibly have. And finally, I just grabbed a wireless microphone and went with it. And that was like the worst. That was the scariest, and I was just sweating bullets.
Am I on now? This is fantastic. This is live TV, ladies and gentlemen. You don't know what's going to happen, huh?
The show was rough, to say the least. One of the dancers had been in a car accident that same day and was heavily sedated. He didn't know how to write a monologue.
Heights, but I read a story in the paper the other day about peacocks that have invaded Hacienda Heights. And I'm not sure if you've ever actually had a peacock invade your neighborhood, but they're one of the stinkiest loud birds, I think, is actually on the face of the earth.
And Frank talked, but no one thought to give him a microphone.
Frank, take it away.
The show continued on, learning from its mistakes.
The band, we're on Rice Krispies. Here's the shot of the band. And I want to know which one of you guys is Snap. I know who Crackle is. I want to know who Snap is.
They secured a drummer for the corner band, Jim Martin. And the crew started to fill out. The dancers were gone, but Lori stayed on to become the show's first announcer and co-host.
Lori, you married?
Yes.
Happily?
Yes.
Good. Glad to hear it, Lauren. Tell Lori we have three ropes. Probably ropes very similar to those that you and your husband have in your bedroom, right?
Doing the show began to be fun, and things seemed like nothing could damper the creativity and hope that it inspired for all those involved.
I don't need to be asked twice!
Just three shows into the run, a personal tragedy rocked the cast and crew. In late October, Marty's 19-year-old brother-in-law, Tony, was murdered.
At this time, on Marty's Corner, we'd like to talk about something that affected quite a bit of us on the show here, and personally for myself, my wife, and her family. About a month ago, my brother-in-law, Tony, was shot and killed. And he was a great, great guy. Those of you who didn't know him, he was the kind of person who put family and friends above all else. Just in the last couple years, Tony and I got real close. And a lot of people don't think this stuff is going to affect you, that it's not going to hit you. It's only on TV. But let me tell you, this stuff is in our backyard, and we need to stop this stuff. On behalf of the family and all the people who have sent letters and condolences and prayers to my wife and her family, I want to thank you.
Marty's wife was devastated and too despondent to make the next airing.
And, Tony was a big fan of the show. And we know he's watching up in heaven tonight. So here's to you, man. Our next show is going to be December 17th. Please join us at Marty's Corner. Peace be with you.
Love you, Tony Loco!
God bless.
Although saddened, the show continued on, and into 1994. It became more entertaining, and for the first time, the TV station had viewers talking about the show.
I think it's terrific. Yes, I do.
Great show. Got to be there.
The show was getting better, the guests were getting better, but I wanted to get better guests. I thought that would improve the show. And I was attending college at the time, and I went to the college and asked them if I could put up flyers. And the college had to, I guess, approve the flyer. And so because of that, they had to take a look at the show, so I gave them a copy of the show.
The college's TV station manager liked it and asked if he could air it in West Covina.
Well, we have been excited to have your show on Channel 56. At least I can say I have.
Thank you for having us.
I was just amazed. I had no idea that we could actually have other people wanting to see the show. We realized that for the first time, I think, that we could actually get this show shown in other cities.
In West Covina, the city of West Covina has picked us up. Channel 56 Crown Cable. Can we hear for Crown Cable? Yes. A little TV on the board, and now we have...
Occasionally, some guests got out of hand.
We had some wrestlers on that got out of hand.
But I think this one's going to be a lot better than what they got going on. Huh? Don't you think so, huh?
Hey, Ben!
Hey, hey, hey! Come on!
They were supposed to come on.
Is that for real? I remember that.
Yes, yes, it was...
For real?
We knew they were going to sign the contract for the upcoming bout on the show, and that was understood ahead of time. But we had no idea it was going to go into the full scale, picking up chairs, and we had audience members nailed and being flying.
Really?
Oh, yeah. And we had shoes flying and everything else. That was a little crazy.
Meanwhile, in West Covina, a viewer saw something else when he began watching the show in May of 1995. Pat Wartink was a meat cutter by trade. This once member of the 60s seminal L.A. rock band Rock Shop, he had become a fixture in the San Gabriel Valley music scene. Pat had an integral part in the very successful Charvel Guitars Company and a sought-out recording engineer with contacts in both television and recording industries. He was always on the lookout for new and unique talent. When he flipped the TV to Channel 56, he saw a show with potential and felt he could help.
I'm right on top of it.
I was watching TV one night, and I was just flipping through the channels. I seen Marty's Corner, and I'd never seen the show before. And the band was playing, but the band really sounded bad. And then after the band stopped playing, started watching Marty and his show with his guests and stuff and the way he interacted with them, I thought, boy, you know, they got a little something there that's a little bit different.
He was right on both counts. It would be more than 2 years before he finally met Marty. With success came celebrations. After each show, the entire cast, crew, guests, and audience would meet back at Marty's to watch a re-airing of the show that same night. Most of the time, the parties would last way into the early hours of the following day.
It's like a group of friends getting together once a month and kind of having a party.
I don't remember too much about the parties. It was just a lot of debauchery going on.
We kind of kid around now that the only reason why I did the show was to have the party afterwards, because, you know, at the party I wasn't performing. I enjoyed it more because I just got to have a good time.
Waking up in the morning in Marty's living room, and I think the entire band, some guests, and maybe some neighbors and relatives or whatever were lying in the living room. Must have been about 8 or 10 people.
With time, the cast and crew became tighter. The show was no longer that badly done program that couldn't get viewers, volunteers, or entertaining guests.
In fact, just last week, my agent called me. Said, Rich, I got a big shot for you. Cable show in High Hacienda Heights. I said, yeah, pinch me, I'm dreaming.
Next step is to sail across the ocean. And was now seen in the city of Laverne on Channel 3.
Nobody seemed to know me. Everybody passed my hide.
And celebrated its first anniversary. Broadcasting live from the local VFW hall in Hacienda Heights, it was the show's first sojourn outside the studio. A camera crew from West Covina Television covered the event.
On August 19th at the VFW hall in Industry, this very unique program celebrated its 1 year anniversary. Marty's Corner, a variety program which is anything but what you'd expect.
Somebody described our show as a pack of horses being let out at 8 o'clock and going till 9 o'clock and we have no control over it.
Actually, wild horses might be a little intimidated on Marty's set. Acts range from exotic belly dancers to rock bands and outlandish comics.
No. We need some new Ken dolls, you know? Ones that are more realistic of what us ladies are gonna get when we grow up. Yeah, like Potbelly Ken.
The show had created a buzz. In early 1995, Marty began to negotiate with TCI Cable Channel 32 to bring his wacky, offbeat variety show to TCI.
Top 9 reasons why our cast.
But before that would happen, a chance future. Meeting on the last show at Channel 33 would change the show for years to come.
I thought it was a puppet show. I mean, I didn't know. Marty's Corner sounds like a kid's show.
John Garside was an 18-year-old intern and theater projectionist with a love of film. He had been videotaping his own productions with childhood friends for years. John had hopes one day of directing TV shows himself.
Oh, that was dirty!
At 18, Marty saw John as nothing more than a goofy, wide-eyed teenager.
I go up and I say, yeah, hi, Marty, my name is John Garside. Really like your show. You know, I'm really impressed. I'd like to try to help you out and write on the show. And Marty comes back at me with, oh, yeah, that's great. And he was gone. That was it. He walked away. He blew me off. He says he doesn't remember. He remembers.
I honestly don't remember John at all. I mean, he was right after a show, and I don't remember meeting him. I really don't.
Within 2 years, John would help Marty and his show to a new beginning and a new destination. The program was now being produced at TCI Channel 32.
TCI Cablevision!
But was still being broadcast at the same studio.
Can hardly contain it, John.
With this change, the show would automatically pick up 150,000 new homes to broadcast to.
To present the most watched live cable show in San Gabriel Valley. Live from the studios in the city of Industry, it's Marty's Corner!
With a new channel comes changes.
Welcome to Marty's Corner, coming to you live from Channel 32 in the City of Industry. First show on Channel 32. Studio One. Of course, there's only one studio here, but we are Studio One.
I don't think they were really big on the rock bands and the comedians and the comedy things we were doing, but I think they're going to go ahead and let that kind of go by the wayside as long as they could go ahead and do what they wanted to do with the show. And they definitely had their own agenda.
Co-host Lori, who had worked on the show for 18 months, opted to leave the show for personal reasons and devote herself to acting. Bass player Albert and drummer Jim were gone too, leaving Frank as the only remaining member of the original Corner band. To complete the now-defunct Corner band, Frank brought in Marty's brother Mike to play bass and a local drummer whose band had once appeared on the show. The new rhythm section for the Corner band, Mike Shields and Steve Ramirez. Marty and his brother Mike had been playing together in bands for over 13 years. He currently worked in the missile defense industry, but his interest in music brought him to the show and an opportunity to work with his brother and Frank again. Drummer Steve Ramirez had a sullen charm and an incredible set of chops. A carpenter by day, he was one of the best drummers in Hacienda Heights and had been sitting in with a local group called Roadkill when Marty asked him to join the show. Marty was used to having a co-host. He needed another. Enter Leanne Engel. A makeup artist and college student, Leanne had appeared on the show in a makeup segment in 1996. When Lori left, Leanne was asked to sit in. She stayed.
Lori was looking to get out. You know, she had things going on in her life. So we brought in Leanne, and initially Leanne was great. You know, she was really into it, and she actually was a really good co-host, to be honest with you. She was really good.
Hi, I'm Marty.
I'm Leanne.
I'm Frank.
Join us here on Marty's Corner, Channel 32 TCI. Is that your hand, Leanne?
No.
Is that your hand, Frank?
Yeah.
Knock it off.
The show was now seen in the cities of Baldwin Park, Pico Rivera, and Arcadia, and now aired in 200,000 homes. For the show's second anniversary, the program again went live from the VFW Hall and had its first recognizable celebrity sit-in with the Corner Band. CBS local weatherman McCloviel Perez.
Oh my God, it is a powered industry. A cold front just came in with a high zone. McCloviel Perez.
Production values improved, as well as segments and guests.
Incredible camera. What kind of camera is this? Do you know?
This is your Sony Betacam Heathkit Slimmer Than a Dumb. Solid veneer.
I can tell. This is great.
And here's another one. Here's a Valentine, a plain old Valentine. No jokes, no variety, no pizzazz, no fun.
Oh, popular.
Just like Marty's Corner.
Oh! Not funny, not funny.
Every morning I wake up, got a headache, and wake up, can't see nothing, cause I got a black eye.
Okay, we have Dave.
The show was trying new ideas, hoping to bring in a larger, younger viewing audience. The Corner had been seen in the city of Laverne for 1 year. When a comedian's adult material raised the ire of a city council member.
Actually, I was driving one day with my girlfriend, and I was hungry, and I said, you know, I like to eat something. And she said, how about a quick In-N-Out? I said, yeah, but let's eat first, you know. So
the show was quickly yanked off the air. The show's sudden rise sparked a local newspaper to write a featured story.
It was a trip because I'm sitting there on the bus, you know, reading the paper, and all of a sudden I open the paper up and here's a big old picture of me and I'm all just, this is great, you know. And
although pleased by the show's success, Marty still realized that he needed to fill a couple of key positions on the crew.
Thank you. Am I here also?
They're just changing.
2 years had passed and West Covina resident Pat Wartink was attending a local production at the Covina Playhouse. He struck up a conversation with a theater volunteer and Marty's Corner cast member.
Well, this friend of mine's wife was in a play. After the show, we were talking to the actors and stuff, and this guy named Mike, which became Crazy Mike, came up and started talking to me and stuff, told me about Marty's Corner, and I said, well, I was watching that on TV and stuff. So he said, why don't you come on down sometime? I think the next show might have been a few weeks later, and I went to TCI, I believe your doing the show there.
Because of the unreliable audio for bands appearing on the show, many acts had refused to play live.
Can you hear yourself now?
Nothing. Then when Marty brought Pat in, overnight it changed.
One of the first musical guests he asked to appear was Rock and Roll Hall of Famer, rockabilly legend, Glenn Glenn.
Well, it's Saturday night at the old dance hall, right here in the City of Industry. You tell her what she means to you, and then you really bop the blues. Everybody's moving tonight.
The show was taken off the air by Channel 56 when a segment about West Covina sites was deemed inappropriate by the city fathers.
We had been seen in West Covina for about a year, so we decided to do a segment on places to go. Of course, it was tongue-in-cheek. It was funny.
West Covina, what a place to be.
But apparently the people in West Covina didn't think it was too funny.
Nonetheless, the show was firing on all cylinders, and Pat's entertainment connections paid off right away.
I didn't know we could wear shorts today, Tom. I would have.
Well, I was wearing my jeans up there, buddy. I had the full country regalia. Boots, jeans, long-sleeve shirt.
I didn't get the memo on the shorts. I would have wore some.
And Rod Steiger and I never rehearsed.
Never?
Never rehearsed a scene. You know, oh, is that me on TV? Gee.
Hey, who's that good-looking guy right there? Huh? Oh, yeah.
I look taller this way.
Nearing the end of the third year, TCI had arranged for the show to be broadcast live as a charity event at the brand new Baldwin Park Performing Arts Center. This was going to be big. TCI's publicity machine had made posters, created TV spots, and arranged newspaper exposure to promote the event.
I think when we were told we were going to do the show at the Baldwin Park Performing Arts Center, we were all just, you know, we're there, we're on our way. That was the beginning.
I am Marty Shields from Marty's Corner. Join me August 24th as we come to you live from the Baldwin Park Performing Arts Center in Baldwin Park. It's a benefit show. Our guests include Rosie and the Originals and Bo Donaldson and the Haywoods.
We had like Rosie and the Originals, Angel Baby. That was big. And we had Bo Donaldson on. I mean, two big stars in one night. We were just like pumped, you know. We had all this press and big huge theater, you know, and all these cameras. And man, we were on the way up.
The chance to do this event with the backing of top-notch TCI cable was great. Nothing could stop the show now.
Marty's Corner, a happy anniversary.
It would become the last show Marty would ever do with TCI. Talk of dismantling the studio at TCI had started before the third anniversary show. Most of the studio's equipment belonged to Marty's original channel, Channel 33. When Channel 33 worked out an agreement with Wilson High School in Hacienda Heights, they saw their chance to move into a new studio and away from the holds of TCI. Channel 33 jumped at it. At the height of the show, Marty had no studio, and the momentum it had created was gone. Marty settled in for a long winter.
That's life.
The studio at TCI was gone. Upset that the channel's assurances were not being kept, Marty made an off-the-cuff remark about his feelings of betrayal to a newspaper reporter, and it got back to TCI.
Initially, I was told that I could do whatever I wanted on the show. I mean, that's what they wanted. They wanted my show, whatever I did on the show. But as we got more into it, they started wanting to tell me what guests they had on, what guests I could have on the show, because they wanted to go and promote something that was going to benefit them and their careers. And after a while, I realized I lost control of the show.
There was no going back. In late December, Marty was invited to an open house at the new studios of Channel 33 on the campus of Wilson High School in Hacienda Heights. He had little hope that TCI would ever rebuild its studio. Besides, he wanted to see this advanced, state-of-the-art, internet, cable-cast-ready studio, the first of its kind in California. He was impressed with the facility, but not all of the station's staff was interested in Marty bringing his show back to Access Television.
I was definitely hesitant about coming back to cable access. And when I went to the open house that night, there was definitely a feeling that I wasn't wanted.
I think seeing Marty walk around the new station, I could tell he was impressed. You could see the wheels were turning. You know, I didn't really know Marty. I knew of Marty's reputation, which turned out to be unfounded.
Marty approached me the night of the open house. By now, he had recognized me from the TV show I was doing. We got to talking, and he kind of just asked me, hey, do you think it'd be cool if I brought my show back to cable access? And I thought, yeah. I told him, I said, yeah, bring it back. Bring it back here.
Relationships had to be mended and others begun. Most of the old crew was still involved in community access. Marty felt that the show had to start again. It had lost some of the momentum after its relationship ended with TCI. With another move came even more changes to the show. Frank stepped down as the musical arranger and leader of the Corner Band. Drummer Steve Ramirez stepped up to the challenge. He brought in two of his current bandmates from his working band, Viva Malpache, Robert Gonzalez, and Alan Lee. Frank was no longer fronting the band and had worked out an arrangement with co-host Leanne to sit in for her when her school schedule would conflict with the show.
I would sit in for Leanne every other show or every other two shows or something like that. Or sometimes I'd be on the show with her.
Bicycling or sending tapes to other cities for possible airing was really taking off. The show added the cities of Walnut, Pomona, Roland Heights, Diamond Bar, and Claremont to the quickly growing numbers of viewers who now watched.
We are now on Channel 3 in Claremont. Claremont, Channel 3!
In keeping with the times, the show also added its first website.
I feel so
John was now directing the show.
The garbage on the lawn.
It took a few months at the new studio, but soon the program was producing quality entertainment again.
And then I moved north to Cabot Cove in Murder, She Wrote. I played the mayor on that show. I did a couple of years.
Oh, yeah. Very
now,
nice.
Jessica, that's 47 people have died in the town this year. Cabot Cove is the murder capital of the world.
And it's not your fault.
No, it's a dangerous place to live,
yeah.
At Cabot Cove.
A lot of the renewed enthusiasm came from the staff members at the now Channel 20. Marty and the crew had begun thinking of creating a retro period piece for some time. Marty's Corner 67.
Hey everybody, from WHS Channel 20, live, it's Marty's Corner, in color.
Marty's Corner 67 was broadcast live in July of 1997.
Live from WHS Channel 20. And today's day, of course, is July 25th, 1967. And
it included a new set and all of the cast and crew dressed in fab gear. The show and the guests were swinging.
Yes. Now, this is a very high cut, what you call the French cut.
Mm-hmm. I'm sorry. Will somebody please hose off the band?
You're a little hot over there.
I never say no to Marty. Ever. I don't care when it is. I say, okay, you just tell me when and where, Marty. Yes, I will be there. So I try to change all my schedules to be there because I don't want to miss an opportunity to participate because it's fun.
Are there any predictions for the country or the United States in general in the next 30 years? Let's see.
No, nothing I could see in the future.
Nothing?
No. I'm better at predicting things, but like tomorrow.
Tomorrow?
I think that tomorrow everybody will wake up and go to work or mow the lawn, things like that.
You're not really a mystic, are you?
No, I'm not.
I said, come on, people now, smile on your brother, everybody get together, try to love one another right now. Right now. Right now.
The show had now picked up the cities of Covina and Whittier. Leanne now left the show to begin teaching, having graduated from college.
So I haven't
Lori returned after 18 months, and she and Frank began to sit in as co-hosts.
She's our co-host in the early stages of Marty Corner. So you're here for Lori. Lori, our co-host. Hi, Lori.
Great. It's wonderful to be back on this raunchy, lovely show again. I missed you, Marty.
And she and Frank began to sit in as co-hosts. During this time, Frank started showcasing his comedic talent.
Safe sex man, right here, ladies and gentlemen. Safe sex man.
I missed one show and I have to go through this humiliation.
That's
I hate you.
Here. Okay.
Actually, I have a strange lack of sensation over my entire body. Oh, Marty, come on. Last month you made me dress up like a condom.
Yeah,
this
well.
Month you make me dress up like this. When's it gonna end?
Well, there'll be something in your Christmas bonus, okay?
I'm not even wearing the right shoes for it.
Come on, just do
all
it.
Right.
Ready?
One ongoing storyline had Frank threaten to kill Marty and having to be institutionalized.
Oh, so you escaped.
Oh, I'm really sorry for trying to kill you, Marty.
It was just kind of an issue you had. You're okay now, right?
I feel great.
You really?
I'm feeling really good.
You stay on that side of the couch if you could, please. It's good to have you back, okay?
It's nice to be back,
okay,
Marty.
Okay. You just, I don't mean to touch you. I won't touch you.
They took away my shoes.
Yeah, I bet they did.
But now something new had invaded the show. Tension among the station staff overflowed into the productions.
Well, I think from the station manager's point of view, she definitely did not like Marty, did not like the show, did not like him being there at the station at all. And she passed that along to me as the staff, why are you helping him out? And it's because it's a good, fun show.
A power play was starting, and Marty was forced to balance the politics of producing the show with his own principles. The show continued, but behind the scenes, things were getting nasty. The station management having requested the staff to report back about any production concerns Marty and the volunteers may have.
She thought volunteer meetings were about getting rid of her, and that neurosis, that anxiety was created by the fact that that's how she got her job.
John was directing the show and refused to spy or lie to Marty.
Should we open up her gifts or send them back?
Send them back!
Grandma got run over by a reindeer. Walking home from our house Christmas Eve.
Went home, started having freaky dreams that I was hanging out at Taco Bell. You're not gonna believe who walked in. Michael Jackson. Boom, 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 boom. Shut! Give me a large burrito, a small enchilito, and nachos to go. Ow!
You claim on March 31st,
keep talking.
Spaceship's gonna land in Garland, Texas.
Non-smoking baby.
I don't have any more babies.
It's gonna land, and out of the spacecraft is gonna come Jesus Christ, who looks like you. Is that right?
No, it's actually Judy Garland who's
coming out. Oh, Judy Garland's coming out?
Yeah. Somewhere.
Okay, well, thank you so much.
Over the rainbow.
Ladies and gentlemen,
since the beginning, Marty had been writing the comedy material for the show. Occasionally, he would seek the advice of Frank and John. At a housewarming, he ran into an old friend and former bandmate of both he and Frank's, Jerry Rennick. Employed by the University of Iowa on a teaching fellowship, it had been 8 years since he and Marty had seen each other. Marty asked him to come down to see the show. Jerry had no expectations.
A mutual friend of ours brought me to one of Marty's shows, and I had a blast. And after that, we started hanging out, doing our... hanging out, playing poker, talking about the show. One thing led to another. Next thing I know, these poker games had suddenly become writers' meetings.
Jerry began writing monologue jokes and sketch humor for the show.
It's the Unabomber. The Unabomber is here tonight.
I want to bomb a shiny house. I want to bomb a materialist louse. I want to plant C4. I want to kill some more. I do not like these jail eggs and ham. I do not like them, Uncle Sam.
All right, get out of the
Jerry, Marty, Frank, and John began writing for the show as a group. The writers' party began to craft a working relationship with each other and improve the comedy writing for the show.
I do everything. I just don't know what to do anymore. I just don't want to do this show anymore. I just don't want to have a new...
You don't have peanut envy, do you?
Oh, good grief.
Well, it's that time of year again.
I don't want to do it. What does he need? What does he need?
The whole show.
Damn it, you know, it's called Marty's Corner for a reason. It's not called John and Frank's Corner. I don't see Jerry's name on there. I'm gonna quit. That's it.
We need the show by next week.
Yeah, I figure we can have it done by then. Hey, what's with the blanket?
It's not a blanket, it's my ex-girlfriend's underwear.
Zoinks!
Tensions had reached their boiling point at the studio. 1 week before the show's fifth anniversary, both engineer Kirk and director John left their jobs at the station.
Things got so bad at Channel 20, with management and everything else, I couldn't stay, and I had an opportunity. Someone offered me a job. And
I thought it was ironic that the Hop wanted me to do the show there because, you know, I tried 5 years before. So it kind of gone full circle.
Live from the Woody Hills Hop, it's the most popular late-night variety show in the San Diego Valley. It's Marty's Corner.
The show was destined to be a success. Marty had booked groups like the Bobby Fuller Four, Glenn Glenn, The Trip, and comedian Gabriel Iglesias.
I fought the law and the law won. I fought the law and the law won. I needed money cause I had none.
Unbeknownst to Marty and his crew, the promoters at the Hop had booked a show on salsa night, having sent the cast and crew into a lion's den. Boos and heckles could be heard.
That was something that they didn't convey to their normal patrons. And they wanted nothing to do with us. And it just got worse and worse, and finally they just said, you guys gotta get out of here.
The show was a disaster. The promoter stopped the show halfway through to allow the regular patrons the opportunity to dance salsa.
You've been listening to The Trip. Thanks, Marty. Thanks, Hop.
We have a comedian who's going to be joining us now in Marty's Corner.
Because we're coming apart at the seams.
After a break. So we're going to go and take a break. We'll be back with Gabriel Iglesias.
Hi,
Don't
Mom.
Go away. We'll be right back. Guys, take us away. We'll be right back. Get out of here.
I'm going to go dance.
Even though being added to the cities of Ontario, Fontana, Rancho Cucamonga, and Chino Hills, Marty was disillusioned with the last show. With everything else that went wrong, Lori was a no-show and left the show again. He learned for the first time that he needed to know his audience. It was a mistake he wouldn't make again. He now brought in John Garside as an outside volunteer to direct. Marty had been using another outside volunteer from TCI for a year, camera operator extraordinaire Karsten Bell. He also began to appear on other TV shows.
Chicks really dig me. I rarely wear underwear, and when I do, it's something mesh.
Oh, yeah. Marty, oh, you're on.
Marty.
Yeah.
I gotta go, bye.
If you're watching Man in the Kitchen, stay tuned. Keep it on Channel 16 because then you will see Marty's Corner. And, of course, the host of Marty's Corner is here today. Everybody give a big warm welcome to Marty Shields.
The quality of the shows continued.
Okay, now just follow her like I always do. You got it. Very nice.
Come on, join with me. I'm proud to be an Okie from Muskogee.
Come here, go there.
A place where even squares can have a ball. Football's still the toughest sport on campus. White line is still the greatest thrill of all.
The show was cool and classic.
Children whom you have seen before, love and joy come to you, and to you like Christmas too. And God bless you and send you a happy new year. And God send you a happy new year.
Now it was time to shake things up again. Another period piece, Marty's After Party, was broadcast live in black and white, circa 1965.
It's Marty's After Party.
We like what we did with the first show, the 67 show, the color one. We took it one step further and did the black and white show from 65, which is kind of like a basis of the old Hugh Hefner show, Playway After Dark.
The cast and crew rehearsed for the first time ever, and it showed.
Very good, very good.
Wait, Mr. Shields?
Why, Mr. Shields? She's very good. We're going to keep her.
Great.
In fact, go get her a drink.
Okay, you want a drink?
Wait, I don't drink, though.
Get her two drinks.
Okay, great.
No, it's okay. Go ahead.
That you can.
Second hand is still moving. Look at that.
It's a new one by the Beatles.
Mr. Shields, the dog's not eating the food. What should I do?
Well, go, you eat.
What?
You eat.
There must be something wrong with it. You eat it.
It's not bad.
For more than a year, Marty had been accused of breaking equipment, using unauthorized personnel on his productions, and undermining the station's policies. None of it was true. Marty was scheduled to broadcast his 6th anniversary show live from his backyard, but the staff at Channel 33 refused to request a production van. He went to his old friend, Kirk Stevens.
Kirk Stevens was nice enough to let us borrow his truck. He was over at Los Alamitos Television doing stuff over there. He was a station manager. We asked him, and he was all for it. You know, he thought it was a great idea.
Thank you, and welcome to Marty's Corner 6th anniversary show. I'm your host, Marty Shields. How are y'all doing tonight? As you can tell, we're coming live tonight from my backyard, Hacienda Heights.
And also, give a huge round of applause for 6 years, 6 great years for Marty's Corner. Let's hear it.
And here they are, writers of Marty's Corner. Guys, we need a joke.
That's a new joke for me? Okay, he says, knock knock. I can't use this. What do you got cooking for us here, Jeff?
You know, Marty, you told me it was going to be a luau theme, a Hawaiian theme. So we've got a special here. We've got Don Ho's salmon.
We were going to have a wrestling match between the mayor of La Puente, Ed Chavez, and the councilman from West Covina, Mike Tuohy, but we don't have time, gentlemen. Next show. Sorry. Oh, I'm sorry.
In late 1999, Marty's Corner had picked up the city of El Monte and was now seen in over 50 cities and communities in the San Gabriel Valley and Inland Empire and broadcast in 500,000 homes. Marty scheduled a show in November of 1999, unaware that he had been banned from the studio.
I had no idea I was banned from the studio. I thought they were just unhappy with me because they accused me of breaking all this equipment and stuff. I had no idea.
Attempts were made to regain his status as an access producer. All of them failed. Hacienda Heights resident Mary Ann King was a member of the station's board of directors and the former host of the 1960s children's show Romper Room.
Pop goes the weasel, and the jack-in-the-box jumps out of his house, and that means it's time for the Romper Room School. And this is Miss Mary Ann saying a very good and happy morning to all of the boys and girls right here in the Romper Room School.
I knew what was the truth of that. And I do not understand why that got as far as it did. And that was unfortunate because it should never have happened. That was not a good political move on the part of the management.
The show was sent packing once before, and Marty went into survival mode. He secured the production van from Kirk again and convinced the owners of the Covina Valley Playhouse to allow him to do a show from their venue.
From the Covina Valley Playhouse!
It was great to do a show from there. We loved it. I always wanted to do a show at a big place like that where we'd go out on the street and do interviews.
Although broadcasting away from the studio was fun and challenging,
I told you to stop that!
The show needed a permanent home.
What? A banana? I can't live off a banana. I gotta pay a lawyer with a banana. Thanks, mister.
For the show to continue and improve,
screw this!
It needed a studio.
Hey! You gotta catch it.
It was also indefinitely shelved. Since the show had first broadcast in 1993, a TV station manager in the city of Whittier had liked the show. Tim Keeler had been producing wild, daring, and offbeat shows in the studios of Whittier Channel 20 for some time. An unlikely savior to the show, he had been aware of the trouble Marty was having at the Hacienda Heights studio. During a conversation with Marty, Tim offered his Whittier studios to broadcast the show.
He was like, come on down, you know, we'll turn the lights on and do your show.
Marty accepted.
I really think if Tim hadn't stepped in when he did, that the show might not have continued.
Used to the studio in Hacienda Heights, the crew was presented a challenge to do the program from this smaller facility. Bands were practically on top of Marty, and the studio audience's capacity was reduced to a mere 15. More importantly than securing a studio, the cast and crew were back together for the first time in 10 months.
Kind of getting our bearings right. In fact, one of the things we realized was, look at this, huh?
We got to get new furniture. I got a rocking chair here.
You got a rocking chair, so we're going to go ahead and fix that on the next show.
That's
pissing.
There they are.
Oh, yeah.
Watch out. Slide this guy on.
Now, do your neighbors know you keep these things in your house?
No.
I mean, I just think.
We have monitors here in the studio. Do you have any problem with this? I mean, are you afraid that's going to steal your soul or anything like that?
No. I think you're thinking of the Native American stereotype.
Uh-huh. But you do live in Whittier.
Well, through the Witness Protection Program.
In February of 2001, Whittier station manager Tim Keeler became the new station manager of Channel 20 in Hacienda Heights. Keeping his word, he began to look into the allegations against Marty and work toward getting the show back in Hacienda Heights. The process would take time to regain Marty's status as a volunteer producer. For some time, Marty and the crew had been badmouthed by previous station management. The show was back in Hacienda Heights. Again, more changes in the cast and crew were to come. Tony Ridley was a teenage friend of John Garside's, helping out with some of John's earliest productions. For some time, he had been helping on John's Access TV show, XTV. His sketch character, Tony the Reporter, was a recurring role that had become a staple on that show for years. A self-styled mover and shaker, he brought a sense of professionalism to any show.
We have a budget here on Marty's Corner where we actually go in and allow Tony to get a new shirt every time we do a show. And he throws them away or autographs them and sells them to a charity.
Along with his ease in front of the camera,
I'm your announcer, Tony Ridley.
Marty also saw an ability to focus and take charge of a situation. When the show broadcast earlier from the Whittier studios, Tony was floor managing. On the trip back to Hacienda Heights, he stayed.
Well, if you do what I want you to, baby, we'll be so fine.
Oh, life would be dream if I could take you up.
The program had gone through many camera operators, Jack Rodriguez being the only constant. The current crew included two cameramen Marty had known for years, but who hadn't worked on the show as crew. Scott Fuller and Patrick Stevens. Scott Fuller was a childhood friend of John Garside's who had met Marty through appearing on John's TV show.
Hello. Hello.
At 23, he was the youngest member of the show's crew.
Hey.
Yo.
Should we take bets and see what breaks down tonight?
Patrick Stevens was a young and very talented video producer.
Met Marty at the city at the 4th of July event at the city of West Covina.
And I met Marty there and worked both with Marty and John Garside directing the 4th of July celebration.
Marty and John felt a connection with this gifted camera operator. In the middle of the 8th season, the writing, the production values, and the quality of interesting guests were solid.
Right elbow, that's the other elbow, the other right. Bring the right elbow in front of the right knee and
like
stretch.
Like Twister!
It is like Twister, basically a standing Twister.
For some reason, we hit a string where the bands were just great.
Just to catch a glimpse, get a sense, there's something today.
I believe that the reason why our bands really improved a lot after the 8th season was it was word of mouth. And they started contacting us because they had heard about, you know, the show to be on was Marty's Corner.
We have another, this one is Smell My Finger, Charlie Brown. Did not make the cut, ladies and gentlemen. Did not. And the last one we have.
Oh, the best for last.
Last one, of course, is It's Not Fudge, Charlie Brown.
Okay, well, thank you so much. He's jumping all the place.
Like I said, they're pretty quick.
Can we hear for John Howard and Julie Kitt?
Yeah.
Wow. We need to go away for a quick break. We'll be right back. Don't go away.
Frank began to devote more of his time to writing for the show and stepped down as the show's co-host.
Now, should we refer to you as Mr. Monkey Man or Monkey Man? What do you go by?
All my friends call me Eminem.
Eminem.
One from my home. Forget my homies. I'll just drink this myself.
Okay, you go right ahead.
Marty didn't feel he needed another co-host. The show was doing just fine. But during a fashion show segment in October of 2001, a young model caught the eye of Marty. Darlene Marcuse was a stunning model and aspiring actress. Looks aside, she was willing to dive right into the show's madcap, offbeat humor.
Oh. There you go. There you go.
That was good.
Are you okay?
Yeah, I'm fine. Okay, what else you got for me, Dave?
She was very comfortable in front of the camera and brought a fresh feel to the show.
You know, you were my first.
Yeah, my first since lunch. Oh, great. Look at that, the pool boy's here. I gotta go.
Sex doesn't matter.
Yeah, I mean, it doesn't matter with you. Hell, I go solo most of the time anyway.
For the first time in many years, the show and the after parties were happening. The younger cast and crew brought in a sense of renewed fun and open possibilities. The show capitalized on this vibe and did the show's 9th anniversary show from Marty's backyard again.
The 9th anniversary show from the backyard was really great. I think it combined a lot of things. We took aspects of the first backyard show, which was good, but it was kind of stiff, and I was sitting down talking to people. And then we took the aspects of the black and white show, where I was just kind of moving through the crowd with the camera and going from place to place.
Getting crazier all the time here on the night, Marty's Corner Anniversary Show.
I mean, it was a crazy show. We had some chick fell asleep on the roof, and we had to get her down at the end of the show. I don't know how that happened, but that's kind of indicative of what kind of a show it was.
In November of 2002, Marty and John attended an opening of a new club in Ontario. Also at the opening was Darlene and the show's fashion consultant, Rigo. One of the major reasons for the club's success was the music being spun by an L-clad-looking DJ, Leonardo Flores. A resident of Upland, Leonardo had never seen or heard of Marty's Corner. John approached him with the idea of appearing on the corner as the show's permanent DJ. Leo accepted.
You see,
out of control.
On the last show of 2002, a scheduled comedian took the show by storm.
Can you please give a warm welcome to Keith Landau? Keith, come on out.
When he was booked to appear in December, he didn't know what to expect.
Thank you very much. Great crowd. Great crowd tonight.
And Viagra's fun for the whole family. Hey, kids, grab the bagels. It's time for ring toss. Yeah, I knew this crowd would like that. And pet lovers, just wrap it in shag carpet. You've got a cat scratcher.
Look, you just showed up. It's Keith Landau, everyone.
Like Leo, he was so impressive, he was asked by the show's writers to join the writers' party.
The first night we're here. Yeah.
Ending its 10th season, the show continues to improve, learn, and bring together the best of new and old.
Now, again, and so you'll be running for re-election, I guess, real soon.
I'll be running from the cops pretty soon.
Oh.
Tonight, I will be speaking at Marty's Corner. I am grateful that there is a lock on the ladies' room door. Because even though the DJ, Leonardo, is very nice and probably gay.
Showcasing comedians on the cutting edge.
I actually find him to be a bit gropey.
Through frustration, disappointment, and personal tragedies, the show continues. The program's variety of entertainment and diversity of guests has created an underground yet loyal viewing audience.
Girlfriend now. Actually, I got out of a pretty long relationship. 3.5 years was with a girl, you know. I'm not gonna lie, I knew it wasn't a workout. You know, I'm a Sagittarius and, you know, she's a whore. So.
All the while, with a rock and roll sensibility. It showcases both upcoming stars.
Gee, just think what I've been missing. Now that I'm finally going out of my mind.
And longtime entertainers. In a media that is difficult to promote and gauge, its impact is enormous. Bridging the gap between public access television and its big brother, network television.
This is live.
We're live. This is not rehearsal.
Oh my God.
No.
This is.
But live is.
We can't stop and start again.
We're going out to La Pointe live.
Hot diggity.
Still, the show inspires us.
You know, I've known Marty a while. I said, Marty, what do you want me to do on the big show? He said, Keith, I don't care. Just keep it consistent with the standard I have set. So with that in mind, I did not rehearse. I have no original material. And to tell you the truth, right now, I am drunk as a skunk.
It held fast to its resolve to never quit and always move forward.
Great, guys.
And where is the show headed now?
Well, we don't really know. I mean, we want to keep the basic format like we're doing, but we want to make changes and improve all the time. And we're looking to find somebody to buy the darn thing. I mean, we've been doing.
And to bring the best of late night variety to the masses. In 1993, the show launched into an unknown media that was at its peak.
Welcome to Marty's Corner. Hi, I'm your host, Marty Shields. And it's Friday night.
In the decade that followed, public access television's voice was diminished due to the coming of satellite television, the internet, and the community's lack of awareness of this untapped opportunity to be heard. As with any obstacle Marty's Corner has faced, it will continue to push on. It's the best of the American dream. Synergy. Thank you. That sucked.